Hello class, welcome to the lesson for today. We are looking at the next part of the topic of Hooke's law. In our last lesson, we had reviewed what we mean by force and the effect of force. Today, we are looking at Hooke's law proper. In our last lesson, we did define what force is, pull or push, with the SI unit in newtons. We looked at the different types of force that we have, contact force and non-contact force. We looked at how to calculate force mathematically, and we did look at the effects of force. Six of them: increase of speed, reducing of speed, change of shape, moving an stationary object, stopping a moving object, causing turning effects. For today, we still look a bit more at force, and then how force impacts on Hooke's law. We'll define a few issues, a few characteristics of Hooke's law, and then we'll have calculations to help us to understand this. So, we did say force can change the shape of an object, and the stretching force, as you can see there, is called tension. Forces that are acting from the same point but moving towards different points. Force can also be compression if they are squashing or acting from different sides towards the same common point. That's compressional force. Force can cause the change of shape. It can cause a wine glass like that to break into pieces when applied on it. And that's because the wine glass has a property which is known as brittle. Brittle refers to substances which are such that when force is applied to them, they don't change shape, but they completely break into small pieces. Resilient materials are those which cannot break easily. For example, most metals are resilient. Apart from a few metals like mercury, sodium, and all that, most metals are very resilient. You really need a very large amount of force to even make them to bend. Breaking them will take even more force completely. That is a property of material. Can be brittle, can be resilient, or can be elastic. Elastic materials are those ones that return to their original shape when the forces acting on them are removed. For example, there we have an elastic rubber band. There. When you stretch on this side and on that side, it becomes longer. But when you remove the fingers that are stretching them, it goes back to the original shape because it is elastic. But plastic materials are such that when they are stretched, they will change shape and they will not go back to the original shape. They will retain their new shapes. So you notice there that in terms of properties of materials, they can be called brittle, they can be resilient, can be elastic, they can be plastic, and so forth and so forth. We can call them to be hard. Now, stretching springs. A spring is a substance like that, which is kind of wound round and round and round. We call it helical. When you have a setup like this, which is a complete stand, you know, the clamp, the stand here, we have a spring attached to the clamp, we have some weights which are being put at the bottom of the spring, and then we have a meter rule on the side, or half a meter rule like this one, which is calibrated or marked, and that enables you to see with this pin the initial reading when there is no weight, and the reading when there is weight, and then the difference will be what we call the extension. So when you're dealing with this experimentally, this is the procedure. First, we place the weights. Place the weight holder, this one, only on the spring and not the position of the pin against the meter rule. Get the reading on the meter rule before you put any weight. Secondly, you add weights, let's say 1 newton, which is the same as 1,100 grams, to the holder, and not the new position of the pin. We record that. Calculate the extension of the spring, the difference between the two readings in points 2 and point 3 will be the extension. We can convert that into meters. Then you can use different forces. 1 newton, 2 newton, 3 newtons, 4 newtons, 5 newtons, 6 newtons. And each term we see the reading. In this case, we try not to exceed 6 newtons, because having too much weight will impact very negatively on the spring that we have here. Every time you put any weight, you get to note down the readings. Now this is a table that shows a typical example of what is to be expected when you do this kind of experiment. The first column, the pin with holder only in millimeters, it will be constant, 450 millimeters. Next, we add some weight. Okay, 1 newton, 2 newtons, 3 newtons, 4 newtons, 5, 6. Each time, we look at the new reading. It is still in millimeters. Then, the difference between here and here will give us the extension, which is in millimeters, but can always convert it into centimeters or meters. Okay, like that. So, eventually, we plot a graph of force in newtons against extension. Extension can be in millimeters or centimeters. Of course, the exponent will be in meters. It will give you that kind of result. If you do the plotting of the extension against force, you're going to get plots on this point which can form a straight line through the origin O. That result is what brings into effect what we call Hooke's law. Hooke's law is as a result of force. We said force can change the shape of an object. It has been changing the shape of the spring. Hooke's law states that the extension of a spring is directly proportional to the force used to stretch the spring. There's a condition, of course, that the elastic limit should not be exceeded. Hooke's law states that the extension of a spring is proportional to the force used to stretch the spring. Proportional means that if the force is double, the extension will also be double. If the force is triple, the extension will be triple. And the line on the graph against the extension will be a straight line, and it will go through the origin. That is Hooke's law. For example, let's look at if we can answer this question based on the definition, based on the statement of Hooke's law. A spring of original length 150 millimeters is extended by 30 millimeters by a force of 4 newtons. Calculate the length of the spring if a force of 12 newton is applied. The original length. Length note is 150 millimeters. The initial extension is 30 millimeters. That will mean the new length should be this plus this, which is 180 millimeters. Just so you know, it's not important to answer this question, but just so you know, that is it. Force being applied now in the second case. We don't know how much force to apply. Sorry, the force applied initially will be 4 newtons. So 4 newtons will cause an extension of 30 millimeters. What about the second force, which is 12 newtons? How much extension will it cause? This is a case of direct variation. 4 newtons extends this by 30 millimeters. What about 3 times as much, 12 newtons? It should cause an extension which is 3 times as much. So this should be 3 by 30 millimeters. That should be 90 millimeters. Because the force initially was 4 newtons, it was triple to 12 newtons times 3. Extension initially was 30 millimeters. It will also be triple because the relationship is proportional. they are directly proportional. So, to answer the question on the board, on the screen, 12 is 3 times n, therefore the linear extension will be 3 times 30, which is 90 millimeters. But the question was, find the length, not the extension, find the new length. So we'll have to take this extension, add to the original length, which was 150 millimeters, to get the new length L2. And L2 will be 240 millimeters. The L2 will be L0 plus E2, extension 2. So what do you mean by elastic limit? Elastic limit is a point beyond which, if you do add more force, the spring completely loses shape, as you can see in this picture here. The spring will completely lose shape if you put more forces beyond what you call the elastic limit. That is the graph that you're going to get. It will no longer be a straight line at that point, as you can see. For rubber band, it doesn't follow this Hooke's law, so it will give you that kind of shape. So Hooke's law says that when a wire or a spring is stretched, the increase in length is or extension is proportional to the load or force applied. This law is not obeyed if the spring is taken beyond the elastic limit, after which it will become permanently stretched. A rubber band doesn't obey Hooke's law. A graph illustrating Hooke's law will have a line that is straight and passes through the origin. So like we say, we are looking at what we mean by force, the effect of Hooke's law, the characteristics of Hooke's law, and the calculation to help us understand it. Write answers to the question on Hooke's law from your textbook in your physics exercise books. As always, read, understand, review, and exercise to see whether you understood topics or not. See you next time.